Thank you very much, Laurent. And we can move now to the last talk presentation from Christophe Rigollet, Implementing Efficient Underground Solutions for a Successful Ecological Transition, a New Challenge for Society and Geoscientists. And Jean-Charles, you are going to present Christophe.
Yes, sure, Lucia. So I'm pleased to introduce the last speaker of tonight before the discussions. So Christophe Rigollet. So as you can see on his bio slides, Christophe is a geologist and he holds a PhD from École des Mines de Paris from 2001. So he spent most of his career in the energy sector. Christophe wears two hats, actually. So first hat, he's a geoscience manager of the CVI group, and he's especially in charge of the integrated studies. For those who doesn't know, CVI is a service company with more than 200-300 expert staff that provides technical expertise to support energy projects worldwide. Second hat of Christophe is director of Geode Energy, and Geode Energy here is again it's a French research consortium dedicated to energy storage, CO2 storage, and geothermal energy. So Christophe, please take the screen and I leave you for your presentation. Thank you.
Good. Could you hear me and see my presentation?
Perfect.
Yes.
Perfect. Thank you, Jean-Charles, for this introduction. And thank you, EG, for this invitation. Good evening, everybody. With this presentation, I will try to convince you that the success of the ecological transition depends on an effective contribution from geoscientists. In the collective imaginary and commode imagery, green energies are an above-ground concept completely disconnected of underground. But in the real world, the low-carbon energy mix includes a large panel of energy sources that depends on Earth's resources. What do we include in the energy mix? Which are the geosciences issues for each component of the energy mix? In Europe, the present electricity generation mix includes gas, coal, nuclear power, wind, and solar power. Note that the coal excluded of the low carbon energy mix will disappear on the horizon 2040 in favor of intermittent energies, wind, and solar power. In France, the electricity generation mix is already a low carbon mix due to the low contribution of gas and coal and the large part of nuclear power. Whatever the scenario, intermittent green energies should develop to the detriment of nuclear power. Note that the energy mix is significantly variable from one territory to another one according to the local geology or climate. For example, the geothermal power, which is a low carbon energy, is present in the Guadeloupe energy mix, while it is still weak in the mainland France, where projects are under development. Also note that when we look at the share of coal and oil in the Guadeloupe energy mix, we can see that a low carbon mix is a real challenge in French overseas territories. In the future, native hydrogen could integrate the energy mix. One field is in production in Mali. Hydrogen seepages are frequent worldwide. A first exploration well has been drilled last year in the US, and hydrogen sources are continually revised upwards. The low carbon energies, current and future, are diversified, but they all have one big thing in common: their dependence on underground resources. This is what I will try to demonstrate in the following slides. First, levelized cost of new energies are competitive with conventional energies, but capex remain high for underground resources due to the exploration and drilling costs. The upstream investments are high, more than 10 million euros for a doublet, and risky. Drilling does not guarantee a discovery. To lower the capex, one of the solutions is to combine the systems using one well or doublet for multiple applications. An illustrative case of optimized system is a combination of a geothermal doublet with a heating network and the injection of CO2. A pilot project is pending in France, CO2 dissolved from geothermal. For this issue, geoscientist input are: imagine you combine systems and define geological configurations compatible with multiple applications for a single well or doublet. Reduce the drilling risk, improving and optimizing subsurface geophysical imagery, geological interpretation and modeling. Improve the drilling time, for example, with more efficient drilling tools. The green energy mix during the energy transition doesn't exclude the CO2 emission issue, especially for natural gas. Today in France, the CO2 emissions from energy sector are around 5 million tons per year, and for other industries, 95 million tons per year. Considering the huge volumes of CO2 emitted by energy and industry sectors, the underground storage, CCS, is the unique relevant complementary solution to CO2 uses to follow the low carbon scenario. In Europe, the first commercial CO2 capture storage project, Northern Light, was launched 2 years ago by the Norwegian government, Total, Shell, and Equinor. CO2 comes from industry in the Oslo region and is transported by shipping and pipeline to an offshore giant storage in North Sea. In France, the CO2 underground storage is possible in geological sites of low to middle size, from 110 kilotons of CO2 per year to 1 million tons CO2 per year. Considering, for example, the combined system geothermal doublet CO2 storage of that coming from the project CO2 Dissolve, 8 million tons of CO2 could be stored by year in France from 200 sites dispatched over the territory. For this CO2 issues, geoscientist input are identifying potential storage sites, depleted reservoirs and aquifers, characterizing the storage capacity and reservoir seal integrity. One of the major challenges is to assess the capacity of the covers to withstand the overpressure due to the injected CO2. Another major issue is the geological storage of unavoidable energies, unavoidable intermittent power, and unavoidable high temperature heat. During the peaks of intermittent electricity production, a significant amount of electricity is neither consumed nor absorbed by the network. To avoid this daily to seasonal loss of energy and to reuse it when necessary, energy must be stored massively. The short-term need of additional storage is estimated at 1.5 gigawatt in France and 3,000 gigawatt in the world, for an increase of 9,000 terawatt hour of intermittent power. Underground compressed air storage and hydrogen storage in salt caverns present high storage capacity and a discharge time between 1 hour and 1 month. Hydrogen storage in aquifer is also possible. Underground compressed air storage and hydrogen storage are a complementary solution to batteries, particularly suitable for huge amount of energy and slow discharge. Underground compressed air and hydrogen storage in salt caverns need thick evaporite deposits. A lot of areas present a favorable geology in Europe and France. For example, the tertiary and mesozoic evaporites along the Rhine-Rhône Graben and in southwest France. These technologies benefit from a strong feedback from the underground natural gas storages in salt caverns. Thousands of caverns are operational worldwide, including 4 salt caverns for hydrogen storage. Ongoing research projects contribute to the development of this short-term solution in French territories as Stopil H or Rostock H from Geodénergie or HyGreen, for example. For these storage issues, geoscientist input are a transfer of geoscientist competencies from natural gas storage in salt caverns and aquifers to hydrogen storage, considering hydrogen specificities. Improve the geophysical imaging of salt dome, integrating various types of data, seismic, gravimetry, magnetism, etc., and geophysical inversion. Explore evaporite basins and predict the geometry of salt dome and salt properties to qualify new sites of underground storage. The other item concerning unavailable energy is the waste, high temperature heat from industry, evaluated to 30% of the total energy consumption. For example, in France, unavailable heat from industry represents a deposit of 100 terawatt equivalent. Today, there is no real operational high temperature heat storage activity in the world. However, there is a pilot project in Germany led by the Karlsruhe Institute for Technology, KIT, which should soon demonstrate the technical feasibility of such storage. The challenge is to restore heat at high temperature, more than 100 degrees Celsius, useful for industrial processes. For this issue, geoscientists' input demonstrate the effectiveness of such a system from research pilot projects, demonstrate the ability of geological formations to store high temperature heat without impact on underground integrity. The global energy transition could increase the total material requirement flows associated with mineral production. This inevitable increase is estimated from 200 to 900% in the electricity sector and 350 to 700% in the transport sector, respectively, from 2015 to 2050. For example, lithium is a strategic metal for the manufacture of batteries, and the world need is estimated at 1,500 kilotons per year by 2030. Current production is insufficient to supply the market and we depend on producers located outside of Europe. However, an alternative supply is being developed to produce lithium from geothermal brine in France. For this issue, geoscientist input improve the physico-chemical processes to extract the lithium of geothermal brine on an industrial scale. It is a challenge of the ongoing R&D project Thermalie and Eugénie. Evaluate the lithium resource in Europe. Today, we consider that 2 million tons of lithium are accessible in the Rheingraben between Sulz and Strasbourg. Extract 80% of the lithium flowing at 300 cubic meters per hour in the loop of geothermal doublette will allow to produce 300 tons of lithium per year. The lithium production of 10 geothermal doublettes would feed the French market and one third of the European market. The subsurface resource access is a real intellectual, technological, and economical challenge for mining, gas, geothermal energy, native hydrogen, and underground storages. The mining and gas discoveries are more and more rare, small, and complex. The standard methodology can be unsuitable, the seismic resolution insufficient, interdisciplinarity difficult to apply. High temperature geothermal targets are not conventional reservoirs. They are volcanic plastic series, fractured basement, faults, etc., particularly deep, more than 2,000 meters. To the complexity of the reservoir itself is added the grid depths with its high temperature, high pressures, which complicate drilling. For example, the reservoir of EGS of the Rheingraben East France are in the crystalline basement at 5,000 meter depths. The exploration of native hydrogen is a good illustration of this issue about access to the resource because the origin of hydrogen is poorly understood. The latest results from ongoing R&D projects show that many preconceived ideas are broken. More and more people consider that native hydrogen is a credible new source of carbon-free energy, ambitious exploration projects are underway. For this issue, geoscientists' challenges are to get out of comfort zones, integrating diverse types of data, developing interdisciplinarity to find new exploratory concepts and hydrogen plays. Imagine a tailored exploration strategies for native hydrogen. Whichever option is chosen, developing nuclear or living nuclear plants, the question of nuclear waste storage remains the same. What are the most favorable sites for underground storage? The world stock of radioactive residues used to uranium mining extraction is 2.3 billion of tons. Residues used to uranium use in nuclear plants is 250,000 tons of heavy metal. The amount of nuclear waste should increase drastically in the next decades, according to all scenarios. The French National Radioactive Waste Management Agency, ANDRA, is setting up an underground storage of radioactive waste in East France. Radioactive waste will be stored at 420 meters depth in a shale formation. For this storage issue, geoscientists' challenge is to demonstrate that geology is favorable for storage without risk to the environment, considering the geotechnical properties of the soil and the physical-chemical interaction between the geological formation and the radioactive waste. The exploitation of underground resources can cause instabilities, fluid pressures, mechanical stress, etc. Some may be perceptible by humans, such as micro-earthquakes, some others more insidious. The wells cross the aquifers, so the risk of pollution due to the casing or cement failures even low exists. This raises environmental and societal fundamental questions. The underground knowledge, the technical mastering, the monitoring, and the strategy of communication allows to get the social license essential for the success of underground projects, as explained by Laurent just before my presentation. To get the expected social approbation of the project, we have to gain the legitimacy, the credibility, and set up a real social governance. The communication strategy is based on geosciences and social sciences competencies, and for this issue, geoscientists' input are the geological risk assessment and treatment, the evaluation of environmental impacts and possible remediations, and the subsurface monitoring strategy for each step's exploration, development, production, and decommissioning. The mining code and the environment code were drawn up to manage the exploration and production of mineral resources, hydrocarbon production, and hydrocarbon storage. It is being revised because it is partially unsuitable for new uses of the underground for energy transition. For this issue, geoscientists' input are the feedback from past and ongoing underground operational projects and pilot projects, the evaluation of the underground potential for the energy transition. Geosciences are a fundamental key for the success of the ecological transition from territory to the world scale. Geosciences solutions are necessary to access low-carbon energy resources, energy storage, critical minerals and materials, store CO2 and radioactive waste. But multiple challenges remain. The exploration and development processes must be optimized to reduce the costs. For the new underground solutions, it is necessary to set up research pilots to demonstrate the relevancy of the entire technical chain. People remain suspicious when initiating underground industrial projects. We must learn to communicate on our project to reassure and share our enthusiasm. The mining codes and codes of environment must be adapted to new uses of the underground to avoid slowing projects. And governments must integrate the underground as a strategic resource in their general policy and support research and our professional sectors on the long term. To conclude, geosciences bring relevant solutions for the success of the energy transition. There is a large market for the geosciences offer in Europe and worldwide, and therefore a real opportunity for numerous job creations in research and industry. Let's continue to promote underground solutions in the ecological transition. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you, everybody, the speakers and the attendants. And we arrive at the end of this after work. And as mentioned, so a big clap, clap, clap to everybody. And if everybody can turn on the video so that we can take pictures of everybody. It's okay? You can take a screenshot for everybody.
Again, this is for the EAG, right? So it should be mentioned, Lucia, why we're doing this, because it's the first event that we do after the confinement. So it's an example for the EAG at European and worldwide level is asking us to show that this can be done. And I think it's a pity in a way that we couldn't get together, especially because I'm really happy about the contribution that the speakers did. So it's a pity we couldn't have a discussion face to face, but I still have to thank everyone for joining and the speakers for listening. I think it's a good example and it's a good inspiration for the decarbonization and energy transition community. I know that two of my fellow members of the committee, including the chair and another founder, are online, so I hope that they appreciated the opportunity of joining this remotely, and I think we'll take inspiration for the upcoming initiatives, and I think we'll be back to talk to the speakers for inspiration.
Yeah, thank you to everybody, and follow us on LinkedIn. We will post something for sure about this after work. Thank you. Bye-bye to everybody.
Thank you, Lucia, for organizing.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you. You can all maybe turn on also the audio if you want to say thank you to the speakers.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye and thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.